Satsitananda Vigraha Anadira Dir Govinda Sarvakarana Karanam.
Krishna, Harinamananda.
Hi.
Hi. Most of you know you as the Harinam guy.
I'm the guy for Harinam.
Maybe you can introduce you a little bit. And me. What you like doing most in Krishna consciousness.
So my name is Harinamananda Das, and I like to dance and chant. And eat prasadam.
Eat prasadam?
Yeah. I think I'm pretty good at it.
How did it all start?
I'm from Australia. I joined in Melbourne. Uh-huh. My dad was a devotee. I never wanted to be a Hare Krishna, but I saw he was very peaceful, so I got kicked by Maya, and then I went to my dad, can I read the Gita? So they gave me signs of self-realization. 6 months later, I'm in the ashram.
Wow.
Yeah, pretty much.
And how did you end up like meeting Maharaj and then saying, okay, he's the guru of my life?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he came through when I first started, but when I first read Prabhupada's books, I understood it was a demon. So if I came with devotees, then I'm thinking like, hey man, they gotta like correct me non-stop and like, because I'm a demon, so it makes sense. But devotees are not like that, you know, they're very encouraging. It's like, oh, you're here, wow, you did that really good, and they just keep encouraging you. So I got used to that encouragement, and when I remembered, when I came, I go, the only person that would really care about me would go out of their way to tell me off. So that's for my expectations of dealing with devotees. So when Kadamba Kanana came through, and there was many Swamis passing through Melbourne, I saw him as someone who's very playful, you know, maybe wouldn't be my guru, but you know, someone very playful with like killer kirtans, he was blasting the roof and then always cracking all these jokes during class. You know, I even like renounced watching a comedy act with my brother. Because I was thinking, no, I should go to Krishna. Wow. And then I had more laughs at his class than at the comedy act.
Wow.
So I was thinking, okay, this is the way to go, the higher taste, you know? And but I never saw him as a spiritual master. And I kept reading, and Prabhupada says, hey, you need one. Forget it if you're going to go back to Godhead. So I started shopping, and I was researching the books, how to find a spiritual master. So they were saying, like, two ways, association and service. So any spiritual master come through the temple, I just go straight to them and go, can I get some association and service? You know, and they'll give me association. Like for example, Harinamananda Swami, he called me to his room and he goes, okay, let's read Krishna book together, and we just read. And then after that would be like, okay, here's some service, can you measure this suitcase? So it'll happen with every personality that come through. And I still never put Kadamba Kanana in the mix.
Wow.
Right? But then he came through and he was only there for like a week. And he just chastised me non-stop. Like, you're an idiot. Why you do this? You know, don't you know how to do anything? And I was thinking, whoa. When he left, I was thinking, oh, he hates me. But then something started burning in my heart. I was just like, wait a minute. Because the other spiritual masters were like my friend. But no one was like telling me off. Only Kadamba Kanana. So then I was thinking, okay, maybe this is someone I should consider taking shelter of. So then I went to Gunamani Nitai Mataji, who's our god sister, and then she gave me the email. I just put in like two sentences, I'm thinking about taking shelter of your lotus feet. He replied, yeah, no worries, we can, you know, I'll give you shelter and we'll catch up when I come through again. I was like, whoa, that was quick. And I was thinking, maybe I won't get another chance with any personality like this. So I go, let's go for it.
Wow.
And that was kind of like the beginning. And then after that, he never really told me off. He was very nice.
It was only the beginning.
Yeah. Krishna's plans work in amazing ways.
So your main service has been now since then doing Harinam?
Yeah. I remember like, I was complaining to my dad, you know, oh, I have all these lusty desires, you know, a young man, and what am I supposed to do with this? And I never said anything to Maharaj. He was serving Maharaj breakfast. And he says, and I was standing there and he goes, can you help him? And I'm like, no, don't tell him. Yeah, this guy has so much lusty desires. Can you help him? Yeah? And then Maharaj says, he knows what to do. I'm like, no, I don't. And he goes, yeah, he knows what to do. If you want to conquer us, make Harinam big.
Wow.
I was like, okay. It hit through. It was like this instruction. So then the Harinam sort of took over the whole life.
Yeah. So yeah. Everything.
And I never thought like I would be traveling or like joining some group or something. I was just on my own. But with the instruction of the spiritual master comes the empowerment. And it's gone to an amazing place, really, hasn't it?
Great. Yeah.
It's nothing to do with me. I never wanted to do Harinam. Forget it. I want to be like some cool bridge preacher, but
yeah. Bridge Maharaj.
Yeah.
And is there any like an encounters, personal encounters with Maharaj, something where you think like you really touched Maharaj's heart?
I touched his heart, or he touched my heart?
He touched. You touched his heart.
Yo.
By doing some nice service or very somebody that you really pleased him.
Yeah, it doesn't sound amazing, but it was to me. Like, I think we did something in, I don't know, it was like a few months, but there's one that stands out now, but I mean, like, we went to Mauritius, and he had so many aspiring disciples after doing the Kirtan Mela there. And then he says, okay, we're a team. You go on the street during the day. So we had some group of young kids, and we'll go to a different market every day, distribute like 200 books and do Harinam. And that was like for 10 days straight. In the evening, we'd meet with Maharaj and he'd do this crazy kirtan, this whole night program. So that was cool. Mm-hmm. And he says, yeah, we're a team.
Oh, that's nice.
And then like we gave the report, oh, we did so many thousands of books and we did every day like this.
Wow.
And he goes, thank you. That's it. Right? He said that. I don't know. For me, it was like, it means something to him, you know? But I didn't.
Oh, it's very amazing. Wow.
Yeah, I never really found anything, to be honest. That like,
I think
oh,
he's
yeah,
so
I
proud of you that you're doing Harinam. He's like,
yeah.
He called you his kangaroo.
Yeah, his kangaroo. Yeah.
Dancing around in the kirtan.
Yeah.
Looking back, like, now all this experience and service with Maharaj over the years, is there anything that you say like you regret not doing or
yeah,
you
so
would
many
have done
things
differently?
He did this like Bangladesh tour,
yeah,
and he sent me like a message about it. Mm-hmm. I kind of just like, yeah, I wasn't ready to jump on the opportunity. I wish I would have done that. I wish that I met his God, the God family much earlier, especially from Europe. I thought they were very, when I first met them, coming to Germany, and I thought they were very inspirational. Germany, Czech, they were like, yeah, because all of you were Sankirtan devotees.
Yeah.
You know, you were running around doing books like crazy, you know, Sabuch with the bass, Gordrum, Jaini Thai, Jwokadish. There's so many, you know, it's just like, if you joined his crew, it means you're on the mission, you know? Mm. So I really valued that association. Most of the mercy, I think, comes through his disciples, to be honest.
Mm. Yeah, it is.
I think, that's where you see, like, his empowerment, you know?
See, the fruit of his work is like, that's the artwork that he's
done. Yeah, that's it, yeah. And the thing is, like, every disciple is so different, you know? You couldn't really, like, pinpoint who disciple
a typical,
they were.
A typical disciple,
yeah, you couldn't really.
But I remember in the beginning, they were always saying, like, all KKS disciples have always glasses. In the beginning, it was like that.
Oh, really?
It must be every, but now it's like, it was when he had, like, 5 or 10 disciples.
Yeah.
But now it's, like, completely, like.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're like, but he is also so colorful and so different, he can relate to so many.
Yeah. Yeah, I've seen that flavor many times before. It'll be like happening in one room. There'll be like a new person, there'll be like an older person, there'll be like a aristocratic Indian, there'll be like some yobba Aussie guy, you know. And you can relate with every single person.
Yeah.
He did this in Mauritius, because in Mauritius they speak 4 languages. Mm. They speak Hindi, Creole, which is like broken French, and English. Mm. And So in the same class, he would speak like fluent Hindi, and they're like, whoa. Uh-huh. And then they speak French, and like, whoa. And then, wow. And then English, and then it's like, wow, who is this person?
Amazing. Yeah.
And then he'll lead this crazy kirtan, so he just blew him out the water, you know.
Wow.
And yeah, in South Africa, you know, he just did this like amazing kirtans, but at the same time, he'll deal with them in a personal level. Like, you know, they have, they like this personal dealings in South Africa, and then, especially like, you know, he'll pull some street talk and it's like, hey, this guy knows us, what's going on, you know? It was amazing how he just like, was always ready to serve whoever would come nearby him. It seemed like that. Even now, like, you know, he's in his bed, it's like, okay, he can't see anyone because we know he'll push himself to serve that person. You know?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, who is this person really, you know? How could we ever meet such a personality that's so caring and always going extra mile? And like, despite like many not reciprocating with that compassion and even going to the point of being like aggressive towards them, and then it's like, still doesn't feel any like bad feelings towards them, hostility. Who does that? Only if you're like beyond this world. It's,
he always went this extra mile. It's amazing. He just gave up his whole self. Yeah. And now looking back in this time where we see, like, we have seen Maharaj decreasing energy and withdrawing. What did you learn from this? What do you take along?
The like months before, or like this recent week?
Recently, weeks, months.
Yeah, it's like, when he said everything, so he didn't leave us hanging. So everything's there. I've been even listening to lectures from like years back, and I was like, okay, yeah, okay, we have something to work with. And then now it's like a final lesson by his behavior, how to die, which is probably the most amazing gift you can give someone. And you know, he's still saying 16 rounds, man. You know, he gets up, bathes, and chants 16 rounds, it's like, yeah, doesn't give us excuse, does it, huh? So yeah, he was, and it wasn't even just the spiritual side, even the material side, it's like he was so capable, he could just figure out problems and really quickly, really easy. Even now he's organizing what we're supposed to do for him.
He's organizing after his own ceremony.
Yeah, yeah, I know, I know. And it's like, yeah, this whole thing, it's like everything's extra. It's always extra, and he never asks for anything in return. And yeah, my prayer I've been reflecting was just like, if we can imbibe the same mood and that mission of going extra for others. But I'm always afraid of getting hurt, you know? That's kind of my hang up. So I'm always half. I'm always half. Yeah.
Testing the water first.
Yeah, yeah, always half, you know. Is this guy legit? I don't know. But you never consider it. This is like mood of Prabhupada, mood of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And yeah, it's like, it's definitely Prabhupada's entourage, you know? It's clear. It's kind of clear, actually, that how much love he has for Prabhupada, how important he is in his life. And it definitely, part of his entourage, even though not like personally present at the same time, but definitely present with him, you know, in service. And that was so important for the whole movement. I'm thinking, what are we going to do without this personality? Because there's so many who didn't meet Prabhupada, and he also showed the example of how to be so much more connected than maybe people even met him personally.
Yeah, he was such a Prabhupada man. Like, I remember in one temple, senior Prabhupada disciples were speaking, and then he spoke, and everybody was like, he's such a more Prabhupada man than the Prabhupada disciples.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's like really into it. How did he get it?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
He's like, wow.
And it's like, it was all free service. You know what I mean? So that's like, even for us, like, he's even leaving before Prabhupada disciples. You know? And so it's kind of like, oh, yeah, our connection to it. He will just show, follow his example, his connection to Prabhupada.
Seeing all of this now, afterwards, we don't know what will happen with all of us. Do you have any message to our family, God family.
Yeah, same as Guru Maharaj, is, you know, be nice to each other. I think that goes a long way. Mm. And then, and like he said, taking shelter of the process, hearing and chanting. Like, I think these were the two main instructions that stood out for us as a family. Mm-hmm. To always try and just take shelter, hearing, chanting. We're going to run into problems, and hopefully the hearing, chanting will be somewhat of a solace. May not fix the problem. And then if we meet whoever it is, if it's God family or like well wishes connected to Guru Maharaj, then yeah, being nice means just, yeah, we're not gonna jump on top of them with instructions, right? Yeah. We're gonna just be there and a shoulder to cry on, I don't know.
Yeah, be there for one another.
But I think the, our instructions are the same as Guru Maharaj.
Yeah. Thank you very much for sharing.
Thank you.
Nice.